Peter, you're thinking you will never be able to do this for large projects with thousands of participants. Well, no. Obviously, in such cases, you will have to meet with a limited number of people. That's why each participation process is tailor-made. You can work with subgroups, and continuous direct communication isn't always necessary. Each project has its own participation trajectory. Recognizing this would only enhance the research process. To me, the essence of participation is learning. Learning skills and being prepared to learn. All participants, I stress all the participants, including the system representatives, must be prepared to recognize in the course of any participation process that it's a process in which, as knowledge keeps progressing to an ever-growing number of participants, it will become clear which is the most obvious solution. In conclusion, in my opinion, architecture is successful only if it's also cooperative. I mean, architecture which flows from an analysis of the problems which have to be submitted to broad research, as should the relevant opportunities. Also, that the consequences of a project are never underestimated. The project is executed by means of a constructive procedure, the concept of equality of opinions is respected, and the procedural scenario is tailor-made to fit the problem and its potential solutions. Cooperative architecture is spatial planning by way of learning participation process. Sometimes the result will look spectacular, and sometimes it will provide a modest solution that effaces itself to blend into its surroundings, perfecting the art of being inconspicuous by its sheer simplicity. Thank you.
Thank you a lot for this great storyboard and for your message, which was very strong. I would like to ask you, what is e-participation making so highly interesting for people and especially for architects?
Well, I mean, it's a new way of dealing with information. It gives a lot of opportunities to collect ideas and to spread the ideas with a community. You have, for instance, Google Maps, Google Earth has a lot of opportunities to show maps with people to start with discussions with. But you should never forget also that there is a group of people who has no access to e-participation.
Because they don't have computers, for example.
Yes. So you must be aware that it's a fine instrument, but you never don't use other methods for dealing with the people to have contact with them.
So the computer and the internet are one of those mediums,
yes.
But we should.
Yeah.
Include the others too for the.
Yes.
Okay. But spreading information, receiving information, sharing and discussing about it, that's the very, very beginning. Mm-hmm. What comes after the transparency?
Well, as I said, each project, in my opinion, is tailor-made. And I mean, sometimes people need first to be inspired to start a debate. So it can be useful, for instance, first let some artists or architects think about a way of how to deal with a place or an urban problem, and then give this as a start for a debate with the public. In other cases, it can be very interesting just on the opposite, to start with the public and start to deal with them before you decide if you even need an architect for a solution. So that's what I mean. When you are as a public authority, you are dealing with problems, you need to find out what would be the best way for organizing your participation with the citizens so that it be the best useful. And for this, even there are experts already in participation who can give the ideas and dealing with you about how what kind of problem there is and in which way you could use their
can
information.
Can solve it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. And in this context, the internet seems to be an ideal medium, an attractive platform to reach, to interest, to involve, to activate not only experts, but also rank and file citizens. Why the internet?
Can you repeat the question?
Why the internet? Why, I mean, we have other mediums too, but why is it so special or so important to include
Well, the internet has, in my opinion, the advantage that's 24 hours a day. Each one can participate at the moment that he wants to participate and that he has the time. But in the meantime, I think what I would like to say also that is, in one way, of course, the government needs to deal with participation, but we also would like to say that we as citizens, we need to learn participation. Because not all of us, but if you look on a lot of blogs or newspapers where you have the opportunity to read article, to give your comments on an article.
Like on YouTube or
yes, yes. Well, I don't do it anymore because...
But you did.
I did it in sometimes, but I don't do it anymore because it's considered as in a lot of cases as a garbage of opinions. In a lot of cases,
with
in
no
a very
sense.
Negative way, without any constructive debate. So, I mean, participation also means for me as citizens that we are aware how a government needs to work, and that we act also in a constructive way. That a government can do something with it.
Okay.
We don't necessarily need to go to an opposition next to each other. But it's a learning process also for the citizens.
Of course, to play together.
Yeah.
And there is another point I would like to discuss. For example, one of us, or let's say me, I'm based in Hamburg, and you're based in Belgium. And let's say we both heard about an interesting survey about a coming museum project in Paris or Rotterdam or where else. Could one, for example, you participate from Belgium and the other one, me, from Hamburg, and vote for or against a project or even propose adding ideas?
Why not? But also one element that is in our opinion is that whenever you have an opinion, you also need to study. I mean, if something comes to a result, there are reasons why they came to that solution. So the first thing to do is, if you are not convinced about the solution, is to find out what are the reasons why they came to this solution. And it can happen that because you are studying yourself all the documents, for this reason it's so important to have the transparency, it can be that by reading all these arguments, you start to be convinced that something which you didn't understand as a good solution, at the end, is maybe interesting. So, but for me, even if I would have ideas about Paris, if I would have studied about
okay.
it,
So it doesn't depend on where you live.
No, not at all.
Okay, what happens if you and me or the others link together in the internet, and even if we don't live all in the same place or at the same place or in the same city, and we just link together to force an idea in another country or city?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think it won't help very much because politicians are only interested in what's the consequences for their own elections. So If there is a great community but not important for their own elections, they probably won't take in account. But I mean, creating a very big group about a project in a certain city, even from abroad, if it's a very essential project, okay, I can imagine that you can internationally work on it. If it's a very local problem, I doubt that you even are able, or using your own friends, but that you are able to really create a dynamic of a discussion international way for a local project.
Okay. Think global, act local. Could it be maybe, is it still actual or is it out of vogue soon?
No, not at all. I mean, as I also say, each project in a certain way has its consequences also for the rest. So that's that. Of course, you need to think global, and that's for me. It's the essential of an architect. An architecture, he has a client, but in the other hand, what he will construct, it will have neighbors. So if he doesn't take in account the neighbors, and even doesn't try to combine the different elements in the city, well, he will create bad neighbors, and he will create a bad society.
So we should include them
all.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much. So